Imagine being able to detangle, dry, and style with one tool. Just in time for back to school, the Infinity Pro by Con Air with the Knot Doctor all-in-one dryer brushes do it all for frizz-free salon results at home. The pink smoothing brush has 136 Flexolite bristles for painless detangling and 1,000 watts of high-performance power for smooth, shiny results. And the purple large oval dryer brush creates glam waves and comes with a bonus volumizing attachment for added lift and volume at the roots. The all-in-one dryer brushes are perfect for all hair types, with three heat settings for customized styling and frizz-fighting technology that leaves hair shiny and manageable. These styling essentials are your prescription for salon results at home. Go to conair.com to get your Infinity Pro by Con Air with the Knot Doctor all-in-one dryer brush or all-in-one smoothing dryer brush now.
The next time I see Dan Horde, I'm calling him Dangerous Dan Horde. It's official. The whole city knows that Dave Lapham is mighty, so I don't need to say that. But Dangerous Dan Horde. James Erpine in for Mo today on ESPN 1530. Thank you so much for tuning in on this gloomy, weird, now sunny, rainy, weird weather Thursday as the Bengals are off. They're traveling to Washington today. We have a ton of Bengals talk coming your way over the next 3 hours. And yes, we will squeeze in some Reds, but let's be honest here. I cover the Bengals for Sports Illustrated. So guess what? You bring in the Bengals guy, the Bengals guy's going to talk Bengals, and that's where we're going to start today. Guests include Ben Baby of ESPN coming up in about 40 minutes. Charlie Goldsmith of The Enquirer. He's in Washington covering the Bengals. He's going to join us at 4:33. And we're going to get an injury update from Dr. Brandon Bowers at 4:20, because there's some injuries. Joseph Osai, you worried about him? There's some injuries that we got to check in on ahead of Friday's game. But we have to start with Mr. Cincinnati. I mean, maybe that's Joey Votto, I guess. But the most famous football player in Cincinnati, probably the most famous athlete in Cincinnati, Joe Burrow. And Joe Burrow is slowly working his way back, or has worked his way back, or however you want to phrase it, from a devastating, excruciating, awful knee injury. And training camp ended yesterday, and the Joe Burrow I saw yesterday in practice was much, much different than the guy that walked through those Paul Brown Stadium doors and out to the practice field across the street from PBS on July 29th. Much, much different. Not that he wasn't confident then, not that he didn't have the same swagger, the same attitude or leadership skills, all of that was the same. But he looked comfortable. Comfortable in the pocket, comfortable in 11-on-11, comfortable in any team drill you can imagine. Comfortable. Is every throw perfect? No. Has he hit a bunch of deep balls in camp? No. And that was the one knock on him last year. They haven't really attempted many. I can count them on both of my hands, how many deep balls the Bengals have practiced and worked on during team drill so far over the past couple of weeks. I was going to say so far during training camp, but camp technically over. But Burrow is different. I've noticed a difference in him. It's not just me. Anybody that's been down there at camp has noticed a difference over the past 11, 12 days or so. And Joe admitted it yesterday when talking to us at Paul Brown Stadium.
Yeah, back to my old self. Feel great. Super comfortable back there. We're getting it rolling. Still got a ways to go before the first game. Still got to get better every day, but happy with where I'm at. 10 more practices. That's it. Just getting more reps. Like I said before, you know, no one was panicked. I wasn't panicked. Just took more reps. Coming off a bad injury, haven't played for a while. Now we're back to normal. 10 practices later, so we're good to go.
Good to go. Good to go. Good to go. Good to go. He's ready, looks ready, feels ready. Here's the problem, and here's the dilemma. Here's the debate that I have in my head. Again, James Erpine in for Mo. This is ESPN 1530. Joe Burrow is not going to play tomorrow. Joe Burrow said he is back to normal. He's ready to go. Later in that press conference, he said, back to my old self. It's great. And I agree. Eye test makes sense to me. The way he's played over the past week and a half makes sense to me. The problem with this is, and the dilemma that they should be discussing right now at Paul Brown Stadium, that's much, much more important than really anything, and we're going to get into the game tomorrow night, but anything outside of maybe the offensive line and the guards there, more important than anything that's going to happen tomorrow night, is whether or not they play Joe Burrow in that third preseason game. August 29th, Miami at Paul Brown Stadium, their lone home preseason game. Will they do it? We know he's not playing tomorrow. And here's why I would, because I'm sure some of you say, hell no, you don't need to play him. Here's why I would. Because Joe came into camp and he thought he was just going to do everything he did during OTAs and wow everybody. And I don't think he expected to feel uncomfortable in the pocket, because that's not something that's ever been him. He's always been comfortable. He's always been able to diagnose. That's his game. Doesn't have the biggest arm. He isn't a Lamar Jackson type athlete, but you know what he is? He's really good at diagnosing what the defense is doing and feeling the defense around him and getting out of the pocket and making plays. That's his game. And so he shows up for camp, and again, he's coming back from an awful, devastating knee injury where he had multiple ligaments repaired. And he's like, ooh, this is different. And he was uncomfortable. I don't want Joe Burrow to be uncomfortable on September 12th, week one, when the Bengals take the field against the Vikings at Paul Brown Stadium. So if the doctors, which they already have cleared Burrow 100%, which they already have, and you know that during this process, when you're recovering and coming back from an injury like the one Burrow suffered, that sometimes there's a hurdle or two mentally that you don't realize you're going to have to face until you face it. And so that's why I'm putting him out there on August 29th. That's why I'm playing him in the preseason. Because if you don't, there is a chance that, oh man, he gets out there against Mike Zimmer's defense and something's off. And that's 0-1. And then, oh my goodness, Chicago, that's going to be a tough defense to face. And I don't want to put him out there when he's not comfortable, 100% comfortable. Practice, even in 11-on-11s, it is different than a preseason game. Ask anybody. So if he's healthy, why wouldn't you play him? He wants to play, and that's the other part of this. Joe Burrow has admitted, man, I want some reps. I need reps. You know who else wants reps with Joe Burrow? Tyler Boyd and T. Higgins and Ja'Marr Chase, and the list could go on and on and on about all the players that have said, man, I would love to get out there on the field with Joe just so we can get our timing down. Here is Joe Burrow yesterday on the possibility of playing in the preseason.
You know, I always want to go out there and compete, but I don't get paid to make those decisions. That's ownership and Zach, and, you know, I trust those guys to make the right decisions for us and for our team, and, you know, we'll see about the next week.
You talk to quarterbacks across the league. Some teams play quarterbacks, some teams don't. Just how do players and quarterbacks feel themselves about the concept of playing in preseason?
You know, nobody really wants to play in preseason until you get on the sideline and you see everyone else playing, and then you kind of want to go out there and compete. I think that's kind of the consensus among the league. And then, you know, it is what it is.
Yeah. How much do you think that can help you mentally play in preseason game before you get to the point?
You know, I think it would help. However many plays I would get, I think it would help. But, you know, we had the same thing last year. We didn't have any preseason. We went out there and, you know, we didn't play great game one, but we went out and executed. So we have that experience, which I think will help me if I don't get out there.
Is it something you try to lobby for? Potentially with one preseason game left after Friday, are you going to do that?
I've been lobbying.
Okay.
I've been lobbying.
How does Joe Burrow lobby to get into the preseason game?
Just saying what plays I might like against Miami. Third downs, first couple plays. I don't know. Just throw some plays out there, put it in their head.
Deep ball to Uzama?
Yeah, something like that.
Deep ball to Uzama. Anyways, that's Joe Burrow yesterday. He wants to play in the preseason. And guess what? He should. He should. It's that simple. Yeah, it's going to take time. But if he's healthy enough to go out there 2 weeks from that date, from August 29th, then, and he's cleared now, why not put him out there? Because the game doesn't matter. It doesn't mean anything. You know how many times I've watched Joe Burrow plant, run, twist on that leg, that surgically repaired knee, this camp? Move, roll out, stop. All of those things. So this idea that, oh my gosh, why would you do it? Because he's going to be more comfortable. Because he's not going to be thinking about his knee as much. Because he's going to have taken live game reps against a real defense before week one. It's that simple. He's telling you he wants to do it, and it's not because he wants to beat Miami. Who cares if they beat Miami? I don't think it's that. I think he knows that getting reps in a real game-like setting is going to help them when everything matters. September 12th, when Paul Brown Stadium's packed and everyone's excited to see the Burrow to Jamar show, to make sure that they're on the same page, to make sure that they can hit the ground running. And the only thing, there's one concern about the preseason and about potentially playing Burrow in the preseason in that final game. And it's a competition that we're going to get to with Ben Baby of ESPN coming up at 3:40. James Erpine in for Mo. But now, as Alex Frank is today's producer, Taryn Bland quit on me. No, I think he moved shifts with Mo. But Alex Frank here today with me. Anyways, what we're going to do now is we're going to start a game. We're on till 6. I don't know how many more reps I'm going to get from 3 to 6 here on ESPN 1530 between now and September 12th when the Minnesota Vikings come to town. So this involves you, every Bengals fan listening. How are you feeling about this team? I need a record prediction. It is prediction day on ESPN 1530. And Mo's going to do it, and I'm sure Tony's going to do it. And guess what? I don't know if I'm going to be back between now and the start of the regular season. Who knows? You never know in this business. But for lack of a better plan for that, I do want to take the temperature, the pulse of the fan base. And I do daily on Locked On Bengals, and I do daily on, you know, allbengals.com and all of those things, but I'm on ESPN 1530. I'm on the home of the Bengals today. So, after hearing Burrow, after reading all the reports that have come out of training camp, we're out of camp now. Second preseason game is tomorrow. How are you feeling about this team? I want a record prediction and why. I don't care if you think they're going to go 2-15 or 15-2. Maybe you think they're going to go 8-9. That's fine. I'm open to it. But I want to hear from you, and I want you to explain why you feel the way you do about the 2021 Cincinnati Bengals. We'll get into mine, my prediction for this team. We'll get Alex Frank's prediction for this team and yours at 513-749-1530 and 1-866-702-3776. I'll also get to your tweets as well at James Rapine. All right, it's 3:17. Just getting started. Plenty to do here. As James Erpine fills in for Mo right here on ESPN 1530. Record Prediction Thursday is underway. James Erpine in for Mo here on ESPN 1530 with you till 6 o'clock. Thank you for tuning in. ESPN's Ben Baby going to join me in about 20 minutes to get the latest on the Bengals as they've officially ended training camp. They're through that. And we're about 3 weeks away from the opener. They play Washington tomorrow in Washington for preseason game number 2. And today, Record Prediction Thursday, it's very simple. Not sure if I'm going to be on with you here on the home of the Bengals, ESPN 1530, between now and the start of the season. So I want to know how you're feeling about the team. Yes, you only got one preseason game and you only had 3 training camp practices that were open to the public. But you've read all the reporting. You've been listening to ESPN 1530. Mo's had a bunch of great guests on, and then he somehow added me to that group. Tony as well, all that stuff. So you have the info. How are you feeling about this team? What record are you predicting for the 2021 Cincinnati Bengals? Greg, hang tight. I will get to you. But first is Mr. Ace. And by the way, if you want to chime in, you can at 513-749-1530 and 1-866-702-3776. Ace, you are first up on ESPN 1530. What's going on?
James! Big Game James! It's just a good start to you, sir.
How you doing, my man?
Quite a while. I'm doing well. It's been quite a while.
Since it has.
But I have got the most nonsensical prediction for the Cincinnati Bengals for their record this year. Only because it's 17 games. And only because I feel like, I mean, it's not. It's a prediction. It's not like I'm some type of analyst or I get paid to talk sports. I just am calling you up because my computer's down at work, and I hate that I don't get to listen to sports talk because of my work schedule. But because of all that and because I'm providing some entertainment for the price of free right now, my prediction for the Cincinnati Bengals in a nonsensical fashion is they will go 10-5-2. They will have some ties just for the sense of, I mean, shoot, it's a nonsensical prediction. So, I mean,
hey,
I think that they've already proven that they can tie other teams.
Man, so
even with
I got to ask you this, though, Ace, with the two ties. Are you talking about missed field goals, made field goals to force overtime? How does it work here?
I mean, I wish it could be a fourth overtime type of tie. But I think in this team's case, it probably will be because poor clock management, something we used to get on our old coaching staff about, that's going to cost them one game. And I predict that will be one of the Browns games, that we will tie Cleveland in Cleveland. And the other tie will be us tying the Baltimore Ravens here for a major upset.
That would be. The Ravens have owned, you know, the Lamar Jackson-led Ravens have owned this Bengals defense. Okay.
Yes, they have. Yes, they have. Matter of fact, remember they beat the Ravens that year. Dang. I think this year they started Dalton and Green. Green got injured. They started off like 5-3 for the break, and they fell apart second half, especially after Dalton and Green were gone. But they beat the stuffing out the Ravens. It should have been like a bigger blowout than that. Yeah. I mean, they beat them like, I think it was like 28-20 or something, but like they had like 21 first quarter. AJ had 3 touchdowns.
Yeah, I remember that. I think that's the last time they beat them. Okay, so 10, yeah. 5, and 2. So is that
10,
playoffs?
5, and 2.
That's good enough for playoffs,
That's playoffs. That's good enough for playoffs.
Wow, I mean, look at Ace predicting playoffs. All right, we're off to a good start.
At least they'll make the rock, paper, scissors championship.
That's right. Hey, man, I appreciate you tuning in and giving me a call, man. Appreciate it.
Hey, I'm grateful for hopefully my work computer being fixed by the people who work in a remote location for my company so I can be more productive. But since I got the opportunity to talk to you, James, thank you for your time, sir.
Yep, thank you, Ace. And, hey, you're being productive. You're listening to ESPN 1530. That's a productive Thursday afternoon. And if you're listening, don't say you're not productive either. All right, let's continue Prediction Thursday at 513-749-1530, 1-866-702-3776. If you're just tuning in, James Erpine in for Mo on ESPN 1530. And let's go to Madeira, pretty close to our Kenwood studios. Greg, you're next up on ESPN 1530.
James, how you doing, man?
I'm well, my man. How are you?
Doing good. You know what? For record prediction, man, I'm going to go 9-8. I was talking to a buddy of mine who was all negative and all that, so I kind of didn't talk to him for a while, but all of a sudden, he just calls me a month or two ago, out of the blue, says 9-8, so that's where I'm going to go with 2, man.
All right, 9-8. Hey, that would be a huge step in the right direction. There's no denying that.
Absolutely, and the main reason I was calling was, you know, you look at Joe Burrow, I mean, the mentality he has come back from an ACL injury, I think a lot of people need to remember, we didn't even know if he was going to be ready for week one, just a couple months ago. Some people thought he may not even come back to week 4. And, you know, when he's out there practicing, you know, people just are freaking out, you know, because of this, because of that. Just chill out. I mean, this is the whole point of training camp, is to get ready for the season.
Yeah. No, I see what you're saying. I get that. Look, if you can get Joe Burrow completely ready to go by week 1, that's a win. Unfortunately, I think if he's going to be 100% ready to go, no doubt, he's going to have to play in that preseason game against Miami.
That is true. I agree with that. I mean, you don't want to risk injury or anything. I mean, that's a scary thing to think of. I mean, you know, when I hear a report saying, oh, you know, Deontay Smith might be playing Friday, you know, I know he's a rookie, but he's kind of proven to me he can play. Or, you know, Joseph Osai, I know we're still waiting to hear about him, but in a way, he's proven me enough where they should have taken him out earlier in the first preseason game. You know, I'm like, just fine. You know, I mean, I'm literally at the point now, James, just like, I only want to play the guys that have a point to play, you know, have a big reason to play to make the team.
Sure, and I understand that, and I think that's the majority. I just, again, to me, it's all about Joe Burrow and how he feels, how comfortable he is. And coming back from this injury, if he does not take any live reps, and he could say whatever he wants, but deep down, and I think he would probably admit this, he's not going to be as comfortable going up against the Minnesota Vikings.
A lot of us are looking for ways to start our day feeling more joy and appreciation. And while some of us write gratitude lists or do yoga, others pour themselves a bowl of their favorite cereal, Honey Nut Cheerios. Because not only are Honey Nut Cheerios delicious, they can help lower cholesterol as part of a heart-healthy diet. So maybe the secret to a great mood all day is a little yoga, then writing your gratitude list over a bowl of Honey Nut Cheerios. Learn more about a heart-healthy lifestyle at Cheerios.com.
Imagine being able to detangle, dry, and style with one tool. Just in time for back to school, the Infinity Pro by Con Air with the Knot Doctor all-in-one dryer brushes do it all for frizz-free salon results at home. The pink smoothing brush has 136 Flexolite bristles for painless detangling and 1,000 watts of high-performance power for smooth, shiny results. And the purple large oval dryer brush creates glam waves and comes with a bonus volumizing attachment for added lift and volume at the root. The all-in-one dryer brushes are perfect for all hair types, with three heat settings for customized styling and frizz-fighting technology that leaves hair shiny and manageable. These styling essentials are your prescription for salon results at home. Go to conair.com to get your Infinity Pro by Conair with the Knot Doctor all-in-one dryer brush or all-in-one smoothing dryer brush now.
If he doesn't take any preseason reps, that doesn't mean you drop him back seven steps and you let this offensive line pass block for 7 minutes. None of that stuff. But just get him in there for 5-6 plays. Maybe they have an extended drive and you take care of him. And there's certain ways to do that. He's a smart quarterback. And so I don't think he's going to take any crazy hits. Even the one that
Bengals talk,
you mentioned Joseph
here on ESPN 1530.
Like, James Irvin and long. Okay, that's fine. Hand it off. Like,
for
it's
more
not a big deal.
Or run a quick pass. With if, preseason game,
you know, Chris Evans
two,
breaks
just
a tackle.
Over,
if that's who's in.
Or
Joe Mixon
hours away
a
or so.
Like, to
let's,
me, you can
Ben
do
Baby.
It to
covers
where
the Bengals for ESPN.
He's getting some game reps
and vice
feels
versa.
A little bit better about
Bengals
himself going
practice.
Into that week one matchup.
And
against
he is
Vikings
on with us.
Well, also,
Ben, I appreciate the time, my man. How are you?
Exactly. Speaking of which, on another note, Carl Lawson, I heard he got carted off the field today. Man, I hope he's okay. You know,
I know, doesn't it? The difference is, at least I don't know about you. I'm not sweating in the studio. It's very nice and comfortable in here. It's a nice temperature. I don't feel like I'm getting a tan. What about you? Are you out? I mean, it's not as hot today, I think.
Yeah, Greg, I agree with you, and I appreciate the call, man. Take care. It was good to see you at training camp.
Similarly, I imagine the takes that we'll be talking about will not be as hot as what they are on the sidelines.
It sucks that loss.
I'm sure they're not. But see, that's why I brought you on, because I'm ready. If you want to drop a hot take or two,
he's been
usually when they do the ESPN.
Make sure you follow him.
We'll talk to Brandon Bowers
Baby on Twitter.
All right, let's dive into it. And Ben, let's start with number 9.
And I'll ask him about Lawson.
Usually, when they do the on-field test over the past few weeks, he says he's more comfortable. I talked about it to start.
Hopefully, that's not the case.
Hopefully
are you buying
strain,
that
or a sprain?
Would you
or
play him in the? I'm gonna send you a bunch of questions here, and you could just go off.
Defensive end.
Are you buying
right,
that he's more
keep
comfortable?
Things rolling. We've got a
would
couple
you play
more calls
that all
here
in the preseason?
Prediction
and what are you concerned about
with,
right now?
Ben Baby of ESPN coming up.
You know,
in just
off,
a few
just
short
say,
minutes,
like
let's go
all the
way out to Los Angeles. Mike, you are next up on ESPN 1530. What's up, Mike?
Directed in my direction. That was slick. I like how I
was Cincinnati.
First off, I am buying all of the what you said. I think that you and I talk every day. You and I see everything.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
Everybody who's been out there can attest to the fact that Burrow looks more comfortable. You can just tell with how he's moving around in the pocket, how he's going through his progressions. You know, there's a couple balls that we saw the other day that the cross with Mike Thomas to, and that ball to C.J. Uzomah, which was absolutely gorgeous. Probably one of the best balls he's thrown in practice or in games as a member of the Bengals. Shows you that he's more comfortable, and you can tell.
Yeah, that's really
that,
cool.
You know,
look at you, man.
Definitely feeling that way.
Bouncing around, seeing all these training camps. What was the coolest part about any of them?
You know, to paraphrase it for a family audience, I think he was not going to, beat around the bush. He was going to tell the truth to the reporters as much as he can. And, you know, I think to the fact that he said that he was good to go and, you know, all systems are go essentially with him now on the field, I think he was telling the truth. And based on what we've seen, that definitely, you know, adds up. I think the one thing that we would want to see, you know, as observers is, is that deep ball going to connect at some point with Jamar Chase or with any of the receivers? I know that Uzomah route, you know, was a deep ball. I said it was deepish because we didn't really know the exact yard it was on that. But I think the one thing that we really want to see is that go ball from Burrow to Chase. I think that's something that's been missing throughout training camp, and Burrow to really any receiver at this point.
Here's the problem, Mike. There is no more 8-8. It's either 8-9 or 9-8.
I'm sure that we are definitely on this side. But as long as he can do all the intermediate things well, throw that cross to Thomas, have that guard Uzama and really be good in that 15 to 20 yard range. It doesn't matter necessarily if he's good in the 30 plus yard range consistently enough, if that makes sense. He just has to be good enough to be able to keep the defense honest. And, you know, you can watch him
work in the
middle of the field.
You know, Justin Fields and Trevor Lawrence and all those guys. Yeah, they're awesome. Yeah, I agree.
So far,
and I'm going to get into this in a bit.
Ben,
ESPN joining us.
Yeah,
so I agree with it. I agree with a lot of what you
said. To rush these guys out.
The deep ball, to me,
not
the
all of them are like
Burrow.
Like, I thought Burrow was
Is
ready to win last year. And the
I mean,
Bengals
we saw a couple early
as a franchise
in camp
as a roster.
To chase.
But I said at the top,
I don't think
you could count
necessarily all these guys are ready.
I mean, I think it's single
digits.
You can count them on both hands. Probably eight
deep balls
total. Between
Zach Wilson, people
T. Higgins and
him. But, man, you've seen
Jamar Chase are going to be your primary targets. You mentioned the Uzama.
Yeah, they definitely have,
which I agree with you. One of the best throws we've seen from Burrow, period.
But they just they haven't tried it much. And the weird part about it, Ben, it's one thing if they just weren't going to be that field stretching type team. But we spent all offseason hearing about explosive plays, downfield plays, push the ball.
I heard that.
They got to get better downfield.
Yeah, he said no about that.
Everybody knew it. And we just haven't seen it in practice at all. It's not like it's just been bad. There's just been very few reps.
Gotcha. Mike, appreciate it, man. Take care.
Thanks
for the kind words.
Yeah,
good stuff there.
Look,
is it a risk to play Burrow?
Yeah.
I mean, I guess there's some risk in it. But if he's 100% healthy, it's not like that would be the one thing. We're up against it. Alex Frank is going to kill me, but I got to get one more in. Let's go to Texas. Steve, you're next up on ESPN 1530. What's up, Steve?
You know, nobody would know what it is.
How are you doing, James?
I'm well.
Definitely happening here. Tampa Bay,
I've seen it from the very beginning.
That looks like it could have went all the way down to Drew, like he said.
Very interesting.
I think that might be how they're going to generate explosive plays. You want to find guys who can do things in the middle of the field, you know, in turn,
that's history.
Yard route.
That's what that is. If they do that, if they win a playoff game, oh my God. I mean, we've seen 12-4, right, recently, you know, 6 years ago now. But, yeah, if they go 12-5 and win a playoff game,
that's
like
the,
about as good as you could ask for this year, so sign me up all day.
To be honest, if that is why one of the reasons why they drafted Jamar Chase over Penei Sewell, then that makes a ton of sense. That logic really checks out. But we'll see what the game plan is going
to
look like when September 12th gets here
and
the Bengals play the
Vikings.
Ben, would you put Joe Burrow in
all that
on August 29th?
Yeah, if obviously the plan is to play him on September 12th.
If they win, it's fun for everybody, because then I have a lot of good stuff to say versus bad stuff.
Absolutely. Without any hesitation, I think you have to put him in there. Just me personally speaking, I know that Zach Taylor in the front office.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Well, hey, if they go 12-5 or if they win a playoff game, either one, I'm giving Steve and Plant, I'm giving you a shout out. Just so you know.
You
said it first.
But I'll tell you what, it's not just Joe Burrow on the field.
All right, man. Take care. Be well.
If I'm a Bengals fan, I want Trey Hopkins at center. I want Joe Burrow under center.
Appreciate you calling in. Good stuff there.
And I want my starting guard combination.
How about that? Optimism, Alex Frank, as he says, man, get the hell out of this segment that's gone way too long. All right, I'm James Erpine, InfoMo. Up next,
and a lot of people
Ben
said,
Baby,
oh, you know,
ESPN.
We did it last
the Bengals
year,
talk
okay.
continues.
And yeah, you know,
the Bengals beat writer that they let in on
that,
a Thursday. That's
also,
next.
Nobody had any preseason, so it was pretty level. You know, everybody was kind of going in blind. So now there is going to be varying degrees of how ready teams are, because some are using the preseason differently. So I would say that if I'm playing for the Bengals and I'm a Bengals fan, I would probably want at least one series. And you've heard all the vested parties, Joe Burrow, Tyler Boyd, Jamar Chase, T. Higgins, you know, even DJ Reed, are all said, you know, it'd be nice to get a series, get some reps, and, and you know, you want Burrow to feel comfortable. That's the most important thing. That's, you know, that's been a storyline this offseason. And I think you want Burrow to feel comfortable going out there week one against Minnesota. If that means getting him a series and if that's worth the risk, I think that is. And, you know, the last thing you want is him to be gun-shy against the ones and that really snowball in week one. So I think that it would be wise, and I think Burrow probably wants to play in that preseason game against Miami. But like he said, those decisions aren't up to anybody but Zach Taylor in the front office.
Yeah, exactly. And I agree with you, and I think that you made the point. Burrow needs to be comfortable, and he clearly wants some reps, so he is comfortable week one. He's cleared. Like, I don't think there's any medical hurdles. You know, it's more mental stuff. And if mentally he's like, man, give me some reps. It's not like Zach Taylor can't design a game plan where he's not getting hit like Brady did last week with Joseph Osai on a third and long. Like, you can game plan around it even in front of a bad offensive line. And that's where I want to go next. And Ben Baby of ESPN joining us. As far as the offensive line goes, we know the tackles. If Trey Hopkins, is healthy, he'll be the center. But doesn't sound like he's going to play in the preseason, so who knows if he's going to be their starting center. So you're already going to have a backup center in there if you play Burrow in the preseason. How do you handicap this guard competition that just, it seems like it's never ending? I don't know if they know and have a better idea now than they did a week ago about who's going to be the opening day starting guards. What do you think about this entire situation where the interior of the line, which was the worst part of the Bengals line last year, is still a huge question mark just a few weeks before the start of the season?
Can we be honest? Is this a safe place for some honesty?
Yeah, man, absolutely. Be honest.
Okay. This is a mess. I'm going to be quite honest. This is not a great scenario, and I know that you can spin it a million different ways and say there's a lot of competition, yada, yada, yada. Let's be very clear here. There's only one new addition to the interior of the offensive line from the offseason, and that's your second-round pick, Jackson Carman, who ended OTAs as your starting right guard. Can we both agree on that? I think that's very clear. That's stated as a matter of fact, correct?
That was certainly the plan, was for him to start at right guard after OTAs, yes.
Yeah, so there you go. And now we're sitting here heading into the second preseason game and probably going into the third without any clear, you know, delineation on who's going to be those starting guards. And I think that's an issue because, you know, we knocked Jim Turner incessantly. And I saw Jim Turner for about 5 years, saw his units for 5 years, and I thought that he did a little too much tinkering going into the regular season or just too deep into camp, whether that be at Texas A&M or even in Cincinnati at times. And the thing is, I think it's not a knock on Frank Pollock, who's now the new assistant coach who's in charge of the offensive line. I think it's a legitimate, you know, factor that they don't know who's going to be those starting guards, and it's taking them a lot longer. And that is not necessarily a good thing. And I think that you need to figure that out pretty quickly and then go with it and get at least a week or two of some solid reps so that starting five can build some consistency. I think Quentin Spain is probably the front runner for that left guard spot. Based on what we've seen, I mean, given the amount of rotations, honestly, it's getting harder and harder to pin down who's going to be that starting guard combination. And I know that Jackson Carman is running with the threes, but in the back of my mind,
oh, come
I cannot
on.
Help. I'm telling you, I think it would be a very bad, I mean, just Ooh. Frankly, it'd be a bad look if Carman is not starting week one. I think you've got to ask a lot of questions of Carman, of the front office. There's going to be a lot of people wondering why your second round pick, who you went down to get, is not starting when that was one of the big tenets of improving this offensive line to protect Joe Burrow. And I think given, you know, we asked Zach Taylor, a couple days ago, can Carman get himself into the physical shape required to be a week one starter? And Zach said yes. That is very clear. And while Carman definitely has some things to learn, I am not going to rule that out, Jackson Carman starting at right guard. I know it sounds crazy, but that is one of your tent poles of the offense, and it would be a terrible look. And, you know, I think that also kind of might mess with the numbers, too, in terms of what guards are you keeping on the 53-man roster. But
would you,
know,
start
right
him
now,
tomorrow? Sorry to cut you
no,
off.
I would not start him tomorrow. Now, would I start him week one? That is a different conversation. And if the Bengals are going to start him week one, let's be very clear here. But I do think that there is a lot of pressure because of how the line has looked, whether anyone wants to admit it or not, the national narrative around how much the Bengals have improved this offensive line, and the fact that you know what you have to do and what needs to be done moving forward. And you know, they've seen some flashes out of Carman. I think it's up to for him to put in the work and really show that he's where they thought he was at the end of OTA. So there's still a little bit of time, and I won't rule Carman out, but, you know, that battle is going to be incredibly fascinating to watch.
Spending another minute or two with ESPN's Ben Baby, who covers the Bengals. Follow him on Twitter, @Ben_Baby. You buying this defense and the hype around it and how well they've played over the past couple of weeks?
I am not. I'm going to be quite honest. I am not buying it yet. I need to see it. I need to see it on week one. I feel a little bad saying that with
Woo.
Certainty, but I'm going to be honest. I mean, listen, it's camp. Like, the number one rule of football is do not buy the hype in training camp or in fall camp in any level of football, high school, college, or the pros. You just do not do it. It is a recipe for disaster and setting bad expectations. I know what the Bengals' defense has looked like. And to be honest, I think Trey Hendrickson and Sam Hubbard and Chidobe Awuzie especially have all exceeded my expectations of what they would look like. Now, the problem is does that mean the flip side for the offense? Or the offense may be a little worse than we thought? Because both things can't be true. The defense can't be infinitely better, and the offense can't be infinitely better, too. One of those has got to give. And so I know that there's a lot of, you know, conversation about how good this defense looks, but I need to see it week one. You know, do we need to see, can Trey Hendrickson carry that production from 2020 in New Orleans with him to Cincinnati? Can Sam Hubbard live up to the expectations of that contract? Can Trey Waynes and Awuzie be that, you know, cornerback combination that they're looking for that they really haven't had the last couple of years? And can Lou Anarumo's unit as a whole be improved and kind of match up to what the money has been spent and the resources spent on that side of the ball? And we're not answering any of those questions. As good as they look in camp, we're not answering any of those questions right now. Those questions don't get answered until they line up against Minnesota. And frankly, it's going to take a few weeks after that, too, to really see the results. So, no, short answer, I'm not buying it. I need to see it to believe it. And that's really the case for this entire Bengals team in 2021.
He's Ben, baby. Make sure you check out his work for ESPN.com. Follow him on Twitter, @Ben_baby. Ben, that's why I brought you on. I knew you'd be honest and you'd bring the legitimate takes. You're like, no, I'm not buying this offensive line. I can't believe what they're doing. I'm not buying this defense. So I appreciate you coming on, my man.
Yeah, thank you again for reminding the listeners of the takes and then plugging me. So I really do appreciate it. Any mentions I get will be sent your way, guaranteed.
Send Ben your hate mail. Good stuff, Ben. Good stuff there from Ben, baby. Oh, man, this has been fun. 1 hour down, two to go. Alex Frank really hates me because I butchered the clock. But here's what I do know, that Jarvis, Jay, and you are up next. So if you want to get in, you want to chime in on Record Prediction Thursday at 513-749-1530, you can. James Rapine in for Mo. It's ESPN 1530. It's 4:07. Alex Frank beat me up during the break because I went way too long last hour. James Rapine in for Mo. Hey, it's been a while, Alex. I forgot the clock. I forgot the clock. It's, man, rookie mistake. James Rapine in for Mo. Dr. Brandon Bauer's coming up in 15 minutes on Joseph Osai, the Bengals defensive end who injured his wrist, but we haven't heard much about his wrist, and the Bengals are saying they're still evaluating, and man, it's almost been a week, and what the hell's going on with Joseph Osai? I'll ask Dr. Brandon Bauer's coming up in just a few minutes. Plus, at 4:33, Charlie Goldsmith covers the Bengals and the Reds. He's in Washington for Bengals preseason game number 2. So we'll talk Bengals, we'll talk a little Reds with Charlie G coming up as well. But Jarvis has been on hold for quite some time and waited through that extended commercial break. So I got to get to Jarvis here. Jarvis, I appreciate your patience. You're next up on ESPN 1530.
Yes, sir.
How are you, my man?
Hello. I'm doing all right, man. I wanted to give a shout-out to you, too, man. You do wonderful work, like the last caller said. So,
Thank you.
I wanted to hand a drop for that. But I feel really good about this season, man. I think, like, I was born a Bengal fan, I should say, because I was born in 1982 during the Freezer Bowl, the same month, January 7th. I really got a good feeling that this is going to be our year. I know it looked kind of hazy starting off, you know, but I feel like, you know, this is the best team we done had since we went 11-2. And I believe when we went into that season, no one even believed that we was going to go 11-2 that year or win the division. So I want to iterate off of what the last caller said. And I think we're going to go 13-4, not
12-5. And wow, Jarvis.
I believe we're going to win the division. I honestly believe that. I honestly believe in, you know, the pedigree of what Joe Burrow brings to the organization and how he feels that we're going to win the division. And I feel like he's going to bring the fight like the rest of the Bengals going to bring the fight. And I do believe in his defense. I believe we got a lot of solid pieces on his defense. It's young, you know, and they ain't got nothing but room to grow. Just as well as the offensive line, I can't say that it's as solid as the defense, but I can say that it got potential as well. So in my mind, I really do believe that we're going to be the cardiac cats this year, and we're going to go 13-4.
All right, let me push back, and I'm not saying I disagree or saying you're wrong or anything like that, because you could be dead right. The NFL is weird, and things like this happen all the time. With that said, Jarvis, why would you believe in – I mean, Zach Taylor, 625-1. What have you seen from him, or what have you seen to think that he's going to double his win total from the past 2 years this season.
Well, one thing that people ain't mentioning that we got hit by the injury-prone bug the last couple of seasons. I mean, it's been horrible. Last year, we had over almost 15 people hurt, you know, and a lot of them were starters. So a lot of stuff that don't be said or don't be put out there is that we went through a lot of injuries, you know what I'm saying? But if it was another team like Dallas or – you know, another team that they feel like they get a lot of national coverage, that they would throw that in there and say that, like, yeah, you know, they was missing a lot of pieces and there was a reason why, you know, that they didn't succeed to the expectations that everyone else thought they might be able to succeed to. So as long as, like you said early, I believe as long as we stay healthy, which is the key with every football team, which is the key to every Super Bowl winning team, stay healthy. As long as we can stay healthy, I believe we're bringing the fight, and I believe that it's a new day. Yelling, who day?
I like it, Jarvis. Hey, man, I appreciate the kind words. Appreciate you calling in and waiting. Sorry it was such an extended wait there, but I hope you're right. That would be a lot of fun, and I know this city and the fans are hungry for a winner, so that would be cool. So I hope you're right.
One more thing. Think about what the Reds. Nobody expected the Reds to be not even in the position they are at right now, much less even be good enough to even have the record they got right now either coming into the season. When everybody was talking about the Reds coming into this season, everybody was saying the same thing they were saying about the Bengals. That they didn't make many moves, and they ain't going to be good this year, and we shouldn't get our hopes up. But it looked like that we could be the sweeper with the Reds. I believe if the Reds make it to the playoffs, that they can make a run for it too.
Man.
Hey, that's just my prediction.
Hey, that's Cincinnati heaven right there, Jarvis. Yeah, I think we'll all sign up for that. Appreciate you, my man. Have a good day.
Thank you.
Good stuff there. We'll get into the Reds in a bit. But it's actually a good tie-in as my man Alex Frank wears a Reds hat today. And I think he's going to the Reds game later. So, you know, Reds Marlins at GABP. You can listen to every pitch on 700 WLW and the iHeartRadio app. James Rapine in for Mo on ESPN 1530. Why are the Reds better than...
Are you interested in immersing yourself in a foreign culture? Have you imagined learning a new language? If so, the U.S. Department of State is looking for people like you to fill roles in healthcare, construction engineering, information technology, foreign policy, and dozens of other fields. Expand your perspective and experience a unique diplomatic career as you represent American foreign policy abroad. Visit careers.state.gov, Equal Opportunity Employer, U.S. Citizenship Required.
15 minutes could save you 15% or more.
My dad used to say that.
Sure, yeah. It's from Geico.
Yeah, whenever I would ask my dad for life advice, he'd sit me down and say, son, 15 minutes could save you 15% or more. And look at me now, a well-adjusted adult with a drawer full of plastic bags I'll never use.
Okay, I'm confused. Was your dad a licensed Geico agent?
Nah, he was just a real good dad.
Geico. 15 minutes could save you 15% or more.
A lot of us expected after the moves they made this offseason, which was basically selling a decent amount of their team, like good parts, like bullpen help, right? Like trading Iglesias for nothing. Oh, my God. Ask the Angels about him. Anyways, why? It's because young players emerged, and they exceeded expectations. And you got a guy in Jonathan India who's probably going to win Rookie of the Year. Certainly one of the two favorites, right? That's what the Bengals need. They need multiple young guys to step up and be better than anybody expected. And right now, it's tough because if you're painting that picture, if you're painting like the 13-4, 12-5 picture where this offense is just dominant and this defense exceeds expectations, well, on defense, they're not banking on many young guys. Yeah, you got Osai, you got Sample. You're talking about some, you know, rotation guys, Tyler Shelvin, young linebackers, I guess. So that would be it. But you're going to be banking on a young offensive lineman to emerge. Maybe it's Deontay Smith. Maybe it's Jackson Carmen. Maybe it's just, you know, the veterans step up. But somebody at guard has got to step up and be competent, probably better than competent for that scenario to play out. You need Ja'Marr Chase to get the dropsies out of his system now so he can be the 2021 Justin Jefferson that went for 1,400 yards for the Minnesota Vikings last year. Like, you need that. You need Joe Mixon to have a career year. You need Burrow to be comfortable from day one. Like, there's just a lot of things that need to go right. And that's the tough part. That's why people were critical of the Reds. Of course, there's a path in baseball for the Reds to make the playoffs and make a run. But their margin of error would have been bigger had they withstood the COVID-19 stuff and not cried poor and not got rid of some of their players that could have helped them right now. And with the Bengals, what I'm going to say, and I'll tell you right now, if they have guard issues, and I'll say it now because they shouldn't be having guard issues. They should have signed another veteran guard in free agency or a guy who could play tackle slash guard where you could move him around. No one has mentioned right tackle as being an issue, right? You know why? Because they signed a proven commodity in Riley Reiff. There's still tackle depth issues, but they went out and got a proven guy. They didn't go out and get a proven right guard. Xavier Suofilo is a journeyman. Jackson Carmen, we'll see. Deontay Smith has exceeded all expectations, is in the running for one of these guard jobs. Like, you just need a lot to happen for this to go right for the Bengals. I'm not saying it won't, but you need a lot to happen for it to go right. And one of the things is health. And we're going to get a health check from Dr. Brandon Bowers of Athletico. He recently moved to Cincinnati, and he's going to join us next to talk about all of the Bengals' injuries, including this weird Joseph Osai saga where we haven't really gotten any info since he got injured on Saturday night against the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. I'm James Rapine. I'm in for Mo with you till 6 o'clock here on ESPN 1530. 421, I'm James Rapine in for Mo, ESPN 1530. Thanks for tuning in on what is now a sunny Thursday afternoon in Cincinnati. Let's keep things rolling with the latest Bengals injury news, and there's some interesting things to go over here with Dr. Brandon Bowers. You could follow him on Twitter at Dr. Brandon Bowers. He's Dr. Physical Therapy for Athletico, and he is on with us now. Brandon, how you doing?
James, I'm doing well. It's been a little bit since we chatted, but I'm happy to be on the show today.
Yeah, I'm happy to have you. Let's start with Joseph Osai, because he's this third-round rookie that fell to the Bengals with the 69th overall pick, and he goes out there in Tampa last week and shows why he was expected to be the top 40-type player. Some thought he was a first-rounder. Falls to the Bengals, and everyone's like, man, he looks exactly like we had hoped. He can disrupt the passer and get to opposing quarterbacks all season long. And then he suffers what I thought was maybe a broken wrist, but we're not really sure. The Bengals have kept everything tight to the vest. What can you tell us about why it's his injury and why it's taken so long for the Bengals to come out and say what's going on with their star rookie?
Like you said, James, it really was lucky that he fell to the Bengals there in the third round, and he was as advertised on Saturday. He had a sack of Tom Brady earlier in the game and then went out with that injury. A lot of times when it comes to really any injury, the team wants to make sure that they have a definitive diagnosis, maybe get a second and even third opinion, like you and I spoke about earlier today, before releasing a diagnosis if something isn't quite as clear cut. So although a fracture would be one of the first things that comes to mind, there's other things that can occur to that wrist. You can sprain some of the ligaments or tear some of the ligaments. So the Bengals are doing their due diligence here before they release a diagnosis. And unfortunately, we haven't heard anything yet.
So does that mean he's gone to specialists, you would imagine, seen multiple? Has he, I assume it's been an X-ray. Does he undergo an MRI as well? What goes into that process?
X-ray and MRI following an injury are pretty standard practice when it comes to NFL injuries. If we're during the regular season, typically MRIs don't occur till Monday or Tuesday. Being that it is the preseason, I would guess that he's had that done already. And then a lot of the medical personnel that they have in-house are usually generalists that might be a specialist in one body part or another. So if the Bengals don't have a hand and wrist specialist on staff, then I presume maybe they send them out to a Beacon or a Christ health system to get that checked out.
All right, I'm going to really make it tough on you here. Dr. Brandon Bowers is with us. So we don't know exactly what the injury is. And there's been some rumblings. I know Jeff Hobson of Bengals.com said that there was at least hope that he could be back for week one. Is that still a likely scenario, given that it's taken this long to kind of evaluate what's going on?
It's really a loaded question. You're backing me into a corner.
I know. So I know it.
I wish I could tell you definitively, James, but without knowing the nature of what's going on, it's tough to say. We consider maybe a knee injury, for example, a bruised knee versus an ACL tear have two completely different return to play timetables. So we're kind of comparing apples to oranges. So as much as I want to be able to say definitively for you and other Bengals fans alike, he'll be able to play week one, it's hard to tell.
I'm going to ask Dr. Brandon Bowers about Joe Burrow in a second for those wondering about the preseason and stuff like that. But let's stick with the rookies. And D'Onta Smith is a guy who's kind of emerged. While expectations were high for Joseph Osai, I think a lot of people thought Smith was going to need maybe a redshirt year. And that hasn't been the case. Unfortunately, he missed practice yesterday with dehydration issues. Zach Taylor said it could cause him to miss tomorrow night's game. I'm not sure if he traveled with the team to Washington, to be honest with you. But is that something that's concerning where they shouldn't play him? Just, you know, what goes into dehydration and how serious is this if he does end up suiting up tomorrow? Because he is in the middle of a competition for a starting job.
A couple things to consider here. We're in the thick of the preseason and training camp when the temperatures are sky high. And so this is probably what led to that dehydration. He needs to make sure, and all players need to make sure, as everybody should, fluid intake, proper nutrition and what have you. So being that this is the preseason, I think the Bengals may exercise a little bit of caution if there's any doubt in their mind that he's not back to normal kind of hydrated levels by tomorrow night when they take on Washington. But like you said, James, he's competing for a valuable role on this Bengals team, so he's going to want to be out there. So the Bengals are going to take this one day at a time. It very likely will be a game-time decision. They'll probably, if he did travel, they'll probably give him some sort of IV prior to the game just to make sure he is properly hydrated. And obviously, I wouldn't expect him to play the entire game, but that maybe gives him the opportunity to be out there for a number of series. So we'll have to wait and see here on Smith.
Brandon, when we look at Joe Burrow, he's talked about wanting to play in the preseason. From what we've heard, he's 100% cleared, obviously still wearing the knee brace, which I think we'll see all season long on that surgically repaired left knee. Is there any medical risk? I know there's a mental aspect to this and recovering from the injury, but is there any medical risk you think if he does play next weekend against the Miami Dolphins on August 29th?
So I don't have any perspective. Hesitation I do have those with the mental capacity and the mental hurdles that he's currently battling. I think the preseason would be incredibly valuable for him to get out there for at least one series so he can go out there and show himself and show the Bengals medical staff that he can do it before week one rolls around. He's 8.5 months removed from his surgery to repair that ACL, so he's ahead of schedule when we look at the normal return to play timetable for ACLs in the NFL is about 11 months. So physically, he's rock solid and he's doing great. He just needs to get over these mental barriers and be able to show himself he can do it so he can go out there and play like the Joe Burrow that we all know that he can.
Okay, so you, from a physical standpoint, it's green light, and then mentally it's get him out there so he is ready to go before September 12th rolls around.
Absolutely, because he suffered a traumatic injury to that knee last year. So until he's out there having defenders and offensive linemen falling around his knee, and he sees that it's okay, I don't think he's going to be back 100% mentally. And so from what the Bengals and their medical staff have said so far, structurally and physically, he's good to go. We just have to exercise some of these mental demons here in order to get him back to his full capacity. This is a very normal thing that occurs with athletes, especially with these major injuries.
Brandon, last question from me, and I appreciate the time. You tweeted about this earlier. Former Bengals defensive end Carl Lawson was carted off the field at Jets camp today. They think it's an Achilles. I haven't seen the official word of it. But you said the on-field tests, I guess, are pretty reliable. Can you give our listeners a little more insight into that?
Absolutely. So the test that's used for Achilles tendon ruptures is something called the Thompson test. And all you do with that test is you squeeze the person's calf. If their foot moves, they're good. If the foot doesn't move, they've got a ruptured Achilles. I actually saw one of these live and in person about a month ago in a co-ed softball league. A guy on our team went down with one, and, I mean, you know right away. And the players know right away, and the medical staff knows right away. So if it is, in fact, ruptured, on-field testing is pretty darn accurate. They'll confirm that with MRI. From there, it's surgery in about 9 to 12 months to return to play.
Just brutal for Carl. Last thing, how you like it in Cincinnati? You just moved to Cincinnati. You're working for Athletico. How are things going? Are you settled in?
Yeah, so far so good. I've been down here about 2.5 weeks. I'm with the same company, which is nice. My fiance is from the area, so she's showed me the ropes and been showing me around. We're always looking for a good new brewery to hit up. Mad Tree's right down the street from us. So far, so good.
Good, good. Well, I will send you my recommendations and make sure if you haven't yet, follow Brandon on Twitter at Dr. Brandon Bowers. Brandon, appreciate the time as always. I'm sure I'll be reaching out during the season. Hopefully not too much, you know, if the Bengals stay healthy, but you never know. So I appreciate the time.
Certainly, James. It's always a pleasure.
Good stuff there from Dr. Brandon Bowers. Again, you can follow him on Twitter at Dr. Brandon Bowers, who now lives in Cincinnati. Good stuff there. Up next, we're going to go from Cincinnati to Washington from someone else who also lives in Cincinnati. Charlie Goldsmith covers the Bengals, covers the Reds for the Cincinnati Enquirer. He's in Washington. He flew there today. He's covering preseason game number 2, and he's going to join us next. It's 4:30. James Rapine for Mo, ESPN 1530. An hour and a half down, an hour and a half to go. James Rapine in for Mo on this suddenly nice and bright Thursday. Thank you so much for tuning in. Let's go to Washington, where the Bengals set to take on the Washington football team tomorrow night in preseason game number 2. Charlie Goldsmith of the Cincinnati Enquirer is there, and you can follow Charlie on Twitter at @CharlieG__. That's 2 underscores, right, Charlie? Am I looking at that right?
Charlie G underscore was taken, and Charlie Goldsmith was too long for Twitter, so you work with what you got. You roll with the punches.
Hey, I was just making sure I got it right so, you know, all the people can follow you. I appreciate the time. How was your flight out to Washington? Everything good?
This flight was better than the last flight because this time I wasn't flying into the eye of a tropical storm. Oh. There are no reports of tropical storms here in Washington like there were in Tampa last week. So that is a win already for the trip.
Yeah, that is a win, even though flying to Tampa normally would be awesome. So I'm not going to, you know, feel too sorry for you, Charlie. That being said, you are in Washington, so let's dive into this game a little bit. What are what's the top three things, the top thing, actually. Joe Burrow's not playing. The top thing you're going to be looking at when the Bengals take the field tomorrow night?
The top thing the entire preseason has been the interior offensive line, and maybe someone not being there could be the biggest story. Deontay Smith, I think, could have very well gotten first-team reps. Someone whose power, whose physicality, and his ability to get to the second level made him a first-team guard within his first week of playing guard with the Bengals. Deontay Smith is questionable with dehydration issues. If he's not there, I'll be tracking every snap, the rotation that goes down, whether or not it's still Quentin Spain and Michael Jordan with the first team the entire time. Whether Xavier Suofilo gets to play in the first half today on Friday, which he didn't last week, and continue to track that position battle that's going to go down to the wire.
Who would you, if you had to handicap it now, who would you bet on for the two starting guards?
Right now, I'd handicap Quentin Spain and Michael Jordan, and here's why. With the small exception of one practice, those two guys have been focused on one position. Quentin Spain has been at left guard, and Michael Jordan has been at right guard. Deontay Smith has played guard and tackle. Xavier Suofilo has played left and right. But those two guys, in addition to being the first-team starters last week, are the guys who have gotten the most consistent reps at one spot. And I think, personally, that there's value in that.
For sure. There's no doubt about it. Charlie Goldsmith joining us. He covers the Reds and the Bengals. And we're going to get to a little Reds with Charlie here coming up. But he's in Washington covering the Bengals week 2 preseason game. And so, yeah, that's the key to me is figuring out this offensive line. Because in a perfect world, Charlie, I would put number 9 in behind that line once it settles next week against Miami on August 29th, just to get him 6 snaps or 7 snaps or whatever it is, just for a series, just so he gets a little more comfortable. How do you feel about the idea of putting the franchise, Joe Burrow, in during a meaningless preseason game, as they say?
I absolutely love this discussion because, you know, we both talk football, we both cover football, and we both love football. But you know who loves football and knows more about football than us? NFL head coaches. And all 32 NFL head coaches have completely different strategies on this. Zach Taylor, one of his mentors, was Sean McVay, who famously rarely plays guys during the preseason. So, since it's still early in the Zach Taylor era, we're still getting a sense of his spin on it. My read and my opinion personally, especially with the Bengals line, is you figure that out first and you have enough confidence in Joe Burrow that you don't force him into a preseason game.
Yeah, yeah, I get that. I understand that. That's interesting. I just think, to me, my concern is, and there's really no way to do it, to know for sure that he's going to be ready. It's the mental side. It's what we saw at the early stages of camp, Charlie. And obviously, we've seen Burrow evolve as camp has gone, and how much more comfortable he is. If getting him 6 or 8 snaps is going to do that, then that, to me, I get it. I'm not, you know, a football savant, but to me, that just makes sense. Like, he saw this unforeseen medical hurdle and attacked it and got through it. What if there's another, you know, hurdle, and not medical, mental hurdle, excuse me, mental hurdle that comes with playing in games and live reps? I mean, it's not like practices are really live. It's thump drill. It's Burrow hasn't taken a hit since November. So that's the part of it where, and not that you go out there and let him get hit. He might not go get hit, but I think it might be good and beneficial for him.
And that's exactly it. I guarantee you there are head coaches who would have had Burrow out there in Washington and maybe even Tampa.
Yeah.
And I completely see that side of the story because that's what Joe Burrow has told us. He said it would help to be in the preseason. But again, my opinion is one way, but I completely see both sides of the story. There's no right answer, and it comes down to your comfort with Burrow and Burrow's comfort with himself.
Charlie Goldsmith is with us. Make sure you follow him on Twitter, @CharlieG_, the most unique Twitter handle ever. As far as this defense, I think that's been the surprise of camp thus far. We kind of knew what the offensive line was. Plenty of question marks there. We know that Burrow is going to capture all the storylines and get all the attention. But this defense is playing at a really, really high level right now. What has impressed you most or surprised you most about this unit over the past 3-4 weeks during camp?
I'll turn to the player who I'll have a big feature on Cincinnati.com tomorrow, Chidobe Awuzie. When the Bengals signed him in free agency, the thinking was the Bengals just lost their top cover corner in William Jackson and replaced him with depth in the secondary, hoping that the combination and the veteran experience of Waynes and Awuzie and Hilton and Ricardo Allen and Eli Apple could make up for having a number one guy. But this week, with the conversations I had with people around Bengals camp, with receivers, with Troy Walters, and with the Bengals coaching staff, Awuzie is a number one guy. It wouldn't shock me at all. In the regular season, he's a guy who covers opposing teams' number one receivers more than even Jackson did last year, because Awuzie has more pass deflections than anyone in camp. He's in every play. And, you know, even Jamar Chase and T. Higgins are having a hard time shaking him. I'm not concerned about their opportunity to be productive this season. I see that more as a reflection of Awuzie.
Yeah, that's fair. And, man, the way he's gone up against Chase, I posted a clip on Twitter earlier today of a fade route. He's just been on Chase's hip, and I think it's going to be great for Jamar. But when they went out and got a guy like that, and you get Cheeto, he's entering his prime, and that's the thing over the past couple of years, Charlie. They've signed all these, you know, defensive players that should be entering their prime, that should still be on the rise, whether it's him, whether it's Trey Waynes, DJ Reader. All these guys should be, Mike Hilton, entering the best play of their life. And yeah, you're right. Maybe everyone focuses on Trey Waynes being cornerback one. I wouldn't be shocked at all if Awuzie is that. And that would bode well for Lou Anarumo and company.
I had a great conversation about this with Bengals wide receiver coach Troy Walters, who was the recruiting coordinator and wide receivers coach at Colorado when Awuzie was in college. So they go way back.
Imagine being able to detangle, dry, and style with one tool. Just in time for back to school, the Infinity Pro by Con Air with the Knot Doctor all-in-one dryer brushes do it all for frizz-free salon results at home. The pink smoothing brush has 136 Flexolite bristles for painless detangling and 1,000 watts of high-performance power for smooth, shiny results. And the purple large oval dryer brush creates glam waves and comes with a bonus volumizing attachment for added lift and volume at the roots. The all-in-one dryer brushes are perfect for all hair types, with 3 heat settings for customized styling and frizz-fighting technology that leaves hair shiny and manageable. These styling essentials are your prescription for salon results at home. Go to conair.com to get your Infinity Pro by Conair with the Knot Doctor all-in-one dryer brush or all-in-one smoothing dryer brush now.
And what Walters told me was, this is the best thing I could ask for as a wide receivers coach. A cornerback who's athletic, as fluid, as technical, and as physical as Awuzie. And obviously those skills translate far beyond the practice field.
He's Charlie Goldsmith. He covers the Bengals and the Reds for the Cincinnati Enquirer. Let's switch gears. Let's talk about the Reds a little bit. They dropped a couple of games to the Cubs, not the way they wanted to end that homestand, or start the homestand, rather. They got the Marlins tonight. Your thoughts on where the Reds are right now?
Yeah, when everyone looked at this part of the season, it was a soft schedule with a weak Cubs team coming to Cincinnati followed by the Marlins. The Reds lost the series because they didn't hit against Chicago, and now they have to go out and win the series against Miami. And that's the most cliche sentence I've ever said, but we're past the point of the year where you can say, you know, the trade deadline is the most important part of the season, or this roster change is the most important part. We're at the part of the Reds season where they are who they are, which is a great offense, a rising pitching staff, and a bullpen that's trying to stick together from a, you know, an ERA standpoint. The Reds are who they are. There's no big change left. I have confidence in the offense. I have confidence in a number of their starting pitchers and a couple of their relievers as well. At the end of the day, this is what you built your team for. And at some point, you get to where your hands are tied, and you have to play the guys you got. These are the guys you got, the guys you trust. Now it's time to go out and go on a playoff run.
The Reds will make that playoff run if?
I'm going to go with if Sonny Gray and Tyler Mahle pitch like top half of the rotation starters the rest of the way. Reds relievers have, last time I checked, one win since July 16th, which means that when they've won, it's because they've gotten these great starts, and the offense has gotten off to a big start as well. It kind of, in a lot of ways, all goes back to the starting pitchers, and the Reds have confidence. Sonny, they have confidence in Tyler, but they've both had ups and downs in their seasons. If they play at the level the Reds honestly still expect them to pitch at, game in and game out, I think the Reds, who are just a game and a half out, you know, if they pitch very well, I think the Reds could very well make the playoffs.
Yeah, I think everybody would love to see that. And we'll be following it all along at Cincinnati.com. Make sure you check out Charlie's article and feature on Chidobe Awuzie. I've watched you do some of the work behind the scenes here on this, so I can't wait to read it. So, Charlie, be safe in Washington, and I'll see you next week during practice.
Thanks for having me. I'll see you soon.
Yep, thanks for coming on. Good stuff there from Charlie Goldsmith. Make sure you follow him on Twitter, at @CharlieG_. Man, that was fun. 2 hours is almost flow all the way by. We're almost out of time in hour two. We'll get to Brennan Jones on baseball coming up in just a bit here on ESPN 1530. Good stuff. It's been an entertaining hour. We get the latest on Joseph Ossai, on Joe Burrow. Dr. Brandon Bauer is basically saying, yeah, physically, get his ass in there. You can put Joe in there. He's good. And he can get past some of these you know, mental hurdles. And then 10 minutes later, Charlie Goldsmith at the Enquirer is like, yeah, look at the NFL head coaches around the league. They're not playing their players. The Chargers aren't playing Justin Herbert. These guys aren't playing. Sean McVay isn't playing his guys. Why would you play Joe? There's an argument on both sides. It's a fun debate. I would play him because, I want him to be as comfortable as possible when he's ready to go up against Danielle Hunter and Patrick Peterson and Mike Zimmer. Mike Zimmer comes to town September 12th in a real game. I don't want my quarterback to be worried about anything mentally if I can do that. And the other thing I go back to, and James Rapine in for Mo today on ESPN 1530. The other thing I go back to, and some of you will remember this. Hopefully most of you will remember this. I'm not that old. But back in 2006, Carson Palmer's coming back from his knee injury. And it's so funny. Like, you hear so many fans are like, Carson was never the same after the knee. I don't really buy that at all, actually. I think the elbow in 08 was kind of a worse injury from derailing what he was doing as a quarterback standpoint. But anyways, the ACL, he tears the ACL in the playoff game, the wild card game, in that January. And he was back in the preseason, week three of the preseason. And it was against Green Bay, the most anticipated preseason game, and I've said this a ton, in Bengals history. And he goes out there and he throws.